So we're in the book of Ezra. We're in the book of Ezra. The book of Ezra is about spiritual renewal. So it's a new year. It's 2017. There's probably, if you started any New Year's resolutions, it may be that Gaio's New Year's resolution to jog 6 miles a day has already gone by the wayside. Yeah. It may be that he never even started that one. But
too late.
One more than last year. The idea is, you can make a lot of resolutions like that. There's one thing that's really important. That as God's people, we continue to learn God's ways. Because that's what God wants. Ephesians 5:1 says
that we're to become imitators of who? Of Christ, right? Jesus was humble. He was loving. He was always filled with grace and truth. We need to learn his ways, right? And so as a New Year's resolution, in order to sort of say, what does God want to change in our lives? We've started the book of Ezra, which is one of the most amazing books in the entire Bible on spiritual renewal. And we've said the majority of people that you will pass on any given day will never, ever have read the book of Ezra. Most will never even heard the book of Ezra. But while they won't read the book of Ezra, they'll likely read your life. And they'll be looking at your life as someone who proclaims faith in Christ. And so this is just a great opportunity for us to take this book and see what the Holy Spirit wants to do in our lives. And so today actually is a lot more encouraging than last week, because today we're going to see God move. We're going to see God move. And maybe there's things in your life right now that you're wondering, will this ever change? Maybe there's things that you've set out in faith to obey God, to believe God, to trust God, and yet you're going, man, is God going to come through for me? Maybe you're thinking, it's been this long and I'm still here, and I'm really just trying to trust him. I'm trying to understand him. I'm trying to obey him. And yet, for whatever reason, it doesn't seem like God is meeting me in this. It doesn't seem like God is answering me in this. It doesn't seem like God is taking care of this. It doesn't seem like all the things that I expected are coming to pass. And you know what? That is what the people of God felt by the time you hit chapter 6. Because let's remember back, Ezra chapter 1, because they're off by the Kabar River. They had gone into Babylonian captivity as Jeremiah 29 had prophesied. And 70 years later, just as God had prophesied in Isaiah 45, 1-8, God had his messenger Cyrus make a decree to send God's people back just as he prophesied. The people left on a 900-mile journey, leaving behind their homes, leaving behind many family members who didn't wish to go, leaving behind everything, walking 900 miles to get to a city that had been burned down and tore down 70 years earlier. They've been there now for 2 decades, 20 years. Remember, they started this process back when they did what? They heard from God. You see, spiritual renewal always starts with hearing from God. You can read the Bible each day, but not really be in tune to listening to it, right? Or you can be in tune to listening to it, but God always speaks to his word. So that if you want to experience spiritual renewal, it starts with listening to God. Second, they came back into what? Fellowship, chapter 2. They reestablished, chapter 3, they reestablished what? Worship. Chapter 4, they faced what? Opposition. You see, if you want to get close to God in whatever area or in all the areas of your life, you need to realize you're going to face opposition. In chapter 5, we saw last week, they just kept going. They just kept going. Do you know how tiring it would be when God, what did God call them to do? Go back to Jerusalem and do something specific. Do you remember what they were supposed to do? Build the temple. In fact, they were to do that right away. Even before they built the walls. Why would that have taken faith to build a temple before you built the walls? Because the walls were your only form of protection. It wasn't like today where you have police and you have military, you have all these structures in place and you have a pretty safe society. Back then, your protection was having walls around you so that those who hated you, and there were many, couldn't just come in and ransack you at any time. And so they were to build the temple before they built the wall, because God had said so. And the temple was unique in their restoration, because what was the temple to the people spiritually? The place where they met with God. You see, back then in the Old Covenant, God set up this temple in Jerusalem where his Holy Spirit would uniquely dwell in the Holy of Holies. And so this was important to their spiritual life. It was an act of faith. So they come back with this goal, and they've sacrificed so much. But at one point, they even get a delay of 16 years. So 20 years in, do you think, I don't know what you're dealing with, I don't know what you think, man, I've been trying to go along, I've been trying to obey God, and it's been so long. Maybe for you it's been that long. But I want to encourage you today, because what we're going to see today is we're going to see God move. And I think sometimes we get it backwards. We say, if I can see God move, I'll obey him. And we should say, I'll obey him, and I'll see how God moves. And that's what the people did. Now, granted, the people did not do this perfectly, and none of us do either. That's why there's a lot of grace, right? Remember Haggai and Zechariah, they come in here, they're prophesying. If you read their books, you find that they were pretty hard on the people because they were pointing fingers at the people for saying, you don't have much interest in this temple building. You see, a lot of the people were kind of like, build a temple? I'm busy. I got work. I got this. I'm building my house. I'm doing a lot of things. And so they were pretty hard on people that way. But in Ezra, he doesn't answer that question. In Ezra, they're looking at the opposition outside the church towards this going on. Do you think, well, let me ask you this. What is God building today? Is he building a temple in Jerusalem? Thankfully, no, right? I don't know about you, but some people are like, yeah, I'm going on this tour of Jerusalem. Have fun, right? There's some crazies over there. Not that they're not here. Could be a good tour, but thankfully, we're not out to build a temple in Jerusalem, right? Besides, there's a mosque called the Dome of the Rock on top of the Temple Mount because this is the time of the Gentiles, the scripture says. What is he building? Jesus says, I will build what? Upon this rock, he tells Peter, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not rise up against it. That isn't to say any individual local church. In fact, you can have individual local churches that fail. Revelation makes that clear. If they walk away from God, walk away from his God word, he will pull the Spirit from them, not from the individual believers within it, but his hand of blessing on that church. But what he's talking about, I'll build my church, he's talking universally. God is involved in building local churches all around the globe, right? That is his work. Just like it was his work to build the temple to bless the people, and now in our day, God is building the church all around the world in various places. And again, when we think about God moving and God answering and God helping and God working, when he was working and when he moved to help the people accomplish what? His will. So when we're looking for God to move and help us accomplish something, we're looking for God to move and help us accomplish what? His will today. So keep that in mind. And so, in Ezra, we're going to actually start back in chapter 5 and verse 17. He says this, now, if it pleases the king, let a search be conducted in the king's treasure house, which is there in Babylon, if it be that a decree was issued from King Cyrus to rebuild this house of God at Jerusalem, and let the king send to us his decision concerning this matter. Now, this is just a continuation of the opposition. If you wanted to serve God, you want to do what he's called you to do, you might typically think, man, if I'm committed to believe God, I'm committed to obey God, I'm committed to do what God wants, everything's going to go smoothly. You really need to read the Bible because many times God does not allow things to go very smoothly for his people. And here again, after an entire chapter or plus of opposition, the opposition continues. All the people groups around the Jews get together, and almost all their leaders sign off on this thing, going to Darius the king, which you can look up in any history book, Cyrus, Darius, all these were kings in Persia. This is all just historical facts, right? And so they went to the king, and they said, king, and basically they're saying, you can't possibly mean that this, they're telling us that all the way back there that Cyrus decreed that they should build this. Can you make sure they're not lying to us? Because they wanted to do away with God's people. These are the same people, by the way, that said, hey, can we help you build a temple? And they said, no. Because why? Because they believed in Yahweh as the only way, and all the people around believed in Yahweh as one of many ways. So they weren't on the same team. Once that polarized to say there's an exclusivity about this God, it angered everybody. Does it still anger people? When Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, and life, and no one comes to the Father but by me, is that upsetting to people today? It's still upsetting to people today. And so they're out to cause problems. So chapter 6, then King Darius issued a decree, and search was made in the archives where the treasures were stored in Babylon. in Ecbatana, in the fortress, which is in the province of Bedea, a scroll was found. This is just factual stuff. A scroll was found, and there was written in it as follows, memorandum. In the first year, this is chapter 6, verse 3 of Ezra. In the first year of King Cyrus, Cyrus the king issued a decree concerning the house of God at Jerusalem. Let the temple, the place where sacrifices are offered, be rebuilt, and let its foundation be retained, its height being 60 cubits and its width 60 cubits. Do you know that's bigger than Solomon's temple? You know what? Cyrus was a polytheistic person, right? He believed in many deities, and they had these sort of localized deities, and he wanted to appease every deity in case any of them were true. And to do that, he even set out to build a bigger temple than Solomon's temple. With three layers of huge stones and one layer of timbers, and let the cost be paid for from the royal treasury. Also let the gold and silver utensils of the house of God, which Nebuchadnezzar took from the temple in Jerusalem and brought to Babylon, be returned and brought to their places in the temple in Jerusalem, and you shall put them in the house of God. Now therefore, actually we'll stop right there. So imagine if you're back as God's people in Israel. You've given 20 years of your life. You've left everything behind. You've faced one opposition after another opposition after another opposition, and here it goes again. One more difficulty on the road to doing what is essentially what God told you to do in the first place, to build the temple. If they succeed in shutting it down, they succeed in keeping the people vulnerable. They can't build the wall till they build the temple. They're at the mercy of these people. Everything in their life is dependent on them being able to do what God's asked them to do. Do you think there could have been some angst amongst God's people when they know everyone around them has rallied against them and they have sent this official letter with everyone signing it to Darius, and Darius is the one man who can shut it all down, right? You think there'd been some angst in your heart? All these years, all this time. But look at this, verse 6. Now therefore, Tattenai, governor of the province beyond the river, Shethar Bozniai and your colleagues, the officials of the province beyond the river, keep away from there. So this is the response. This is Darius, right? The people had to be thinking, if you could think of the best case scenario, maybe whatever you're praying for, whatever you're working towards, you first need to ask, is this serving what God wants done? Secondly, you need to say, how might my obedience need to be I need to go obey and go long in my obedience before I see God move. By this time, they're exhausted. By this time, they've gone 20 years. By this time, they are going, is God going to answer me? Is God going to move? Is God going to change things? But look at this. King Darius, verse 7, leave this work on the house of God alone. Let the governor of the Jews and the elders of the Jews rebuild this house of God on its site. Is that positive for them? Is this an answer to the Jews' prayer? You see, Darius, and nobody goes against the king. Nobody. Ends up, Darius, instead of doing the politically expedient thing and going with these people and going, forget the search, let's just shut it down. He does the search, he finds out Cyrus had the same view as Darius. He too was into all of these deities and wanted to appease them. Was Darius a saved man? He wasn't any more saved than Cyrus. Did God use his polytheistic ideas to still bless God's people? He did. Is God sovereign enough over things that he can use whatever he wishes, even unbelieving rulers, to accomplish his goodwill? You better believe it. That's why when we look at elections or whatever, and as God's people, we don't need to be in free fall over things or necessarily elated like everything, yeah, they're going to save us. God raises up rulers and brings them down. This is, we serve a king. The king is named Jesus Christ. He controls the nations of the world. And so he goes on, but it gets better. Verse 8, moreover, I issue a decree concerning what you are to do for these elders of Judah in the rebuilding of this house of God. The full cost is to be paid to these people from the royal treasury out of the taxes of the provinces beyond the river, and that without delay. What does he say? By the way, not only I want you to leave them alone, you guys' taxes I'm giving to them. I'm going to tax you, and I'm giving it to them. Do you think God's people could have seen this coming? You see, sometimes when you go long in your obedience, Scripture says that he can do exceedingly abundantly beyond all you can think or ask. sometimes what we need is just to go along in our obedience and trust that, hey, if we've really discerned what God's will is, then we just got to keep going, and no matter the opposition, we got to keep trusting that God is going to move in our lives. Whatever is needed, verse 9, both young bulls, rams, and lambs for a burnt offering to the God of heaven, and wheat, salt, wine, anointing oil, as the priest in Jerusalem requested it. It is to be given to them daily without fail. Can you imagine this? All these people who hate the Jews are now having to give them every day all these supplies so that the Jews can go and worship Yahweh. Crazy. That they may offer acceptable sacrifices to the God of heaven and pray for the life of the king and his son. So the king's like, man, if this is a real God, I want his approval. So this is how he's doing it. And I issue a decree that any man who violates this edict, a timber shall be drawn from his house, and he shall be impaled on it, and his house shall be made a refuge heap on account of this. Darius says, by the way, in case you think I'm joking around, he says, anybody who goes against my edict, I want you to go to his house, I want you to rip out a 2x4 and run it through him. Then I want you to burn their house to the ground and turn it into a garbage dump so that everyone knows that anyone who went against my word dies at it. So do you think God's people could have foreseen how God would take care of business? Man. May the God who caused his name to dwell there overthrow any king or people who attempts to change it. So he says, in fact, I'll call on that God. Anybody who seeks to overthrow me or any of this command that I'm given, he says, I'm going to call on that God to overthrow them. Wow. I, Darius, have issued this decree. Let it be carried out with all diligence. Sometimes what you're praying for, God has plans way beyond that. In fact, God has plans beyond what you can think or ask. But the question is, we've got to make sure that what we're praying for is consistent with his will. Back then, he was praying for what? Back then, they were working towards building a temple. Today, he's working towards building groups of people, localized groups of people who are becoming like Christ. That's his whole plan, his whole goal. Like back then, God's people really struggled to get a vision for that. They had a vision for their homes. They had a vision for their jobs. They had a vision for a lot of things. They struggled to have a vision for the temple. Do you think that could ever be true in our day? You see, we need to make sure that our vision is a similar one to God's, and then we have to go long in our obedience. So he goes on. Then Tattenai, the governor, and the province beyond the river, Shethar, Bozni, and their colleagues carried out the decree with all diligence, just as King Darius had sent. Did they do it? Can you imagine the Jews? Now, they had a point. A lot of times, God's people do worse when everything goes well. It's like, oh, man, I got the job. Okay, I'm good now. A lot of times, it's in tragedy that God brings difficulty before we go, you know what, all along, I should have been serving you. I should have been worshiping you. I should have been, I'm sorry. Until God lifts the pressure, and you would think we would just go, yeah, and we just follow him all the more. But a lot of times, when the pressure comes off, we drift away. Well, he goes on, and the elders of the Jews, verse 14 of Ezra 6, were successful in building through the prophesying of Haggai and the prophet and Zechariah, the son of Iddo, and they finished building according to the commandment of God. Who had commanded they build this thing? God did. Did they get the work done? All these long years later, do you mean that their obedience and faith paid off? They're now in a place where they can commune with God as they had long ago. They're now in a place where they can fellowship with God and with one another in a way they hadn't done for a long, long time. And they finished building according to the commandment of God of Israel and the decree of Cyrus, Darius, Artaxerxes, kings of Persia. All of these kings, historically, were all unbelieving kings who God used to accomplish his work for God's people. Do you know God still wields the universe for the good of his people? So when you go into free fall over things and you go, the election, this, or you go, yay, that's it. You need to stop and say, your sights are set on the wrong level. You see, there is a king. There's a king above all kings. There's a king before all kings. There's a king over all kings. There's a king who's eternal. There's a king who's limitless. There's a king who's tireless. There's a king who never sleeps or slumbers. There's a king whose arm is never too short to help his people, and his power is never limited. There's a king to whom all kings will ultimately bow a knee and acknowledge his supremacy over. There's a king. And he says, this temple was completed on the third day of the month Adar. It was the 6th year of the reign of King Darius. You can go back historically. You can go to Darius's 6th year of his reign. That was the year the temple was completed by God's people. And the sons of Israel and the priests, the Levites, and the rest of the exiles celebrated the dedication of the house of God with joy. They offered for the dedication of this temple of God 100 bulls, 200 lambs, 200 rams, 400 lambs, and as a sin offering for all Israel, 12 male goats corresponding to the number of the tribes of Israel. Then they appointed the priests to their divisions and the Levites in order for their service of God in Jerusalem, as is written in the book of Moses. And listen to these last few verses. The exiles observed the Passover on the 14th of the first month. Keep in mind, they could not go through all this without having the temple rebuilt. There was processes and things that they had to go through and sacrificial systems and stuff like that that hadn't gone on in a generation. They're finally back where they can obey God as he said. For the priests and Levites had purified themselves together. All of them were pure. Then they slaughtered the Passover lamb for all the exiles, both for their brothers, the priest, and for themselves. The sons of Israel who returned from exile and all who had separated themselves from the impurity of the nations of the land to join them, to seek the Lord God of Israel and ate the Passover. And they observed the Feast of Unleavened Bread 7 days with joy, for the Lord had caused them to rejoice and had turned the heart of the king of Assyria towards them to encourage them in the work of the house of God, the God of Israel. Now, if you'll notice something, they had joy. They rejoiced. They had joy. They rejoiced. They had joy. They rejoiced. Do you know that the very things that we find after long periods of obedience is what? Joy. You know what 2 Corinthians chapter 1 says? That those who are leaders or servant leaders to God's people are working for their what? For their joy. Do you know the very thing that you pursue and I pursue and that we are looking around for is joy, right? Here's what Psalm 90 says of that. Oh, satisfy us in the morning with your loving kindness that we may sing for joy and be glad all our days. Would you like that to describe your life? That you would sing for joy and be glad all your days? That is what you're after. But you know what? The very thing that we're after sometimes eludes us. Have you ever met a Christian who doesn't have the joy of the Lord? Who isn't glad all their days and isn't rejoicing in God? That can happen, can't it? It can happen and it has happened to all of us. And so what he does is he moves in extraordinary ways that the Jews could never have even imagined. Not only does he say, I want you to leave them alone, he says, on second thought, I want you to give all your money to help them build. Actually, on the third, I want you to know I'm going to kill every one of you who doesn't do it. God had blessed them. God had moved. He moved historically. He's moved historically in every generation. Remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? They were so, the king was so enraged that they wouldn't bow to his God. He sends them into the fiery furnace. Who knew that they could be fireproof, right? When they walk out, he says, I change that. Instead of killing them, I'm going to kill you if you don't worship their God, right? Crazy. But what you find is God is calling each of us to trust him and believe him and obey. He is still out to build something, not a temple anymore. He is out to build, not steeples and buildings, but a collective local bodies of believers who are working towards holiness and Christ-likeness in their life. That's what he's doing. That's what he wants us to be doing. And so when you think about these things, and you think about how God moved, I want you to think about those things in your life and say, those ways that you think, man, it doesn't feel like God's coming through. It doesn't feel like God's answering. It doesn't feel like God's moving. It doesn't feel like God's accomplishing these things. I don't get it. You need to ask yourself, is it that you're on the right track and you just need to keep going? Or are your goals altogether different than God's and you need to recorrect and make your goals the same as God's and then go along? There's no doubt that as God's people, God intends for you to be filled with joy and be glad all your days. That doesn't erase the difficulty of life. You'll still face the difficulty of life like everybody else. There'll still be floods, especially if you live in Jersey Village, that are going to not be too much fun for you, right? We don't have the sunshine on our house and our neighbor stays under some cloud all their life, right? We are in this together. We're all in a world that's fallen. It's just that we've come to realize there's only one God. And he loves people. And he loves his children, most of all, those who come to faith. And so how did God's people survive all the opposition? They survived because of God, right? Because God in his sovereignty brought them back to land and enabled them to rebuild the temple. And so God, with phenomenal abilities, helped his people to overcome in a historic way that displayed his glory. Yet the God we worship is not a tribal deity. Darius, Cyrus, Artaxerxes, all of them got that wrong. They're not tribal deities. A deity for these people, and a deity for that people, and a deity for that people. And it's not as though, hey, all these deities are really pointing to the same God. It's not it. You see, we worship one God. Not a god, not a tribal deity, not a construct of our own minds, rather the one God who existed eternally and from eternity past and has all power in himself. A God who claims to have created all things in the world. A God we worship that's completely good, completely holy. In him there's no evil, and he's never done anything that isn't perfect, right, holy, and just. And sometimes when we start to think, isn't God doing something? Isn't God going to hear? Isn't God going to answer? Isn't God going to come through for me? We start to question God, don't we? In Isaiah 40, though, he says this, and we'll wrap it up. In chapter 40, God's people were struggling in a different situation with going, man, is God going to come through? Is God strong enough? And he says this in verse 25, to whom then will you liken me that I would be his equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who has created these stars, the one who leads forth their host by number. He calls them all by name because of the greatness of his might and the strength of his power. Not one of them is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and assert, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord and the justice due me escapes the notice of my God? Do you not know? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not become weary or tired, and his understanding is inscrutable. He gives strength to the weary, and to him who lacks might, he increases power. Though youths grow weary and tired, and vigorous young men stumble badly, yet those who wait for the Lord will gain new strength. They will mount up on wings like eagles. They will run and not get tired. They will walk and not become weary. So I just want to encourage you this morning. God moved for his people then. When his people, imperfectly as they may have done it, when his people set out to do his will, not their own, God met him in that, right? God sovereignly helped them through all the opposition, and out of the other side, they were filled with what? Filled with joy. There is nothing more joyful in life than to be intimate with God, to see his hand in your life, to see him move through your life, to speak the truth in loving ways to others, to know and rest in the fact that he has your life, that he actually wills the entire universe for the good of his people, and that you're okay, and you're going to be okay, and that eternity is going to be amazing, and that right now we can rest in his sovereignty, and we can set out to do his will, and if everything comes against us, it's okay, and if nothing comes against us, it's okay. We just need to figure out, what is God doing today in building his church, building his people, a collective people who are learning to walk in holiness and righteousness and truth and love. And how can we, in that, play our part? Because each of us has a part. Let me pray for us. We're going to take communion. Father, I do thank you that unlike the temple of old, you are building your people, the church. I thank you that every person who is saved has been given spiritual gifts to encourage one another, challenge one another, to show what you're like to one another and to the world around us. Lord, we pray you'd give us broken hearts for the lostness of people around us. We pray that you would continue to change us. Lord, there's so many ways we're not like you. We want to be like you. We pray that you would renew us, that we would hear from you, that we would draw near in fellowship as the early church did, that we would make sure that worship is that we've reestablished worship with you in those areas where we might otherwise worship other things. We pray when that opposition comes, Lord, that we would just keep going and that we would see you move and that your movement in our lives would be refreshing not only to us but to all around us, that they would be able to recognize there is a God and that you would use us as your hands and feet to proclaim you and to show others through loving them and speaking truth to them. Thank you for this time, Lord, even as we take communion, I pray you do business with us in our hearts, that we would do business with you, making sure that we're getting sin out of our lives in those ways that we're not like you currently, that we would confess that we would acknowledge that sin, that we would seek your forgiveness, and that because of your mercy and because of your grace, that it would wash over us. And as we celebrate through these elements, that you actually came to this earth as God and yet became a man, walked among us, and died on a cross, absorbing our punishment, and then rose from the grave, never to go back again. It is our firm confidence that we will follow you, that we will follow you into eternity, and that you will welcome us there. So thank you that our sin is already gone, that we didn't come here to learn how to be loved, that we are loved. For every one of us who've come to believe your gospel, Lord, if any here don't know you, they have never come to repent and believe, I pray today is a day of salvation for them. God, help us to hunger from the deepest part of our soul for an intimate, more intimate walk with you, never allowing us to be content in our spirituality, even though allowing us to be content with all the other things in our life. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Thank you.